Hey everybody, it's Eric over at Breakthrough Broker. I'm super excited to be doing this webinar today. Please, we are live here from Denver, Colorado. Let me know where you're calling in from. Go to the chat bar, the chat button. Tell me where you're dialing in from today. We always like to look through and see who's joining us on our webinars. And again, this is crazy. We're doing an alternative marketing strategy webinar today, and we had over 2,000 registrants. And that just makes me believe that we are, as a community, we're so interested in going out and finding buyers and sellers, people who want to buy and sell real estate, because really that's the core of our job. So again, welcome everybody. Tell me, as we let everyone trickle in, tell me where you are calling in from today. And as we get started today, I really want you guys to, hello everybody. As we get started today, I want you guys to ask questions. I want you to make comments. This is an abstract lesson today. We're gonna be talking about some stuff outside the box, and really, It's a passion of mine, because I don't know if you guys know this, but most of us had a past life, right? We had past careers before we got into real estate. And my past life, I worked for the city of Fort Collins, Colorado, and as a police officer and detective. And so as I was a police officer in Fort Collins and I did real estate, my world was predictable. I got paychecks every 2 weeks. My insurance was paid for. My pension was paid for. It was awesome, right? And then I left police work to do real estate full time. And it was like crazy. We had no, it freaked me out. And so we're going to talk about today, we're going to talk about waiting for business as opposed to going out and getting business. We're going to talk a lot about that today. Please ask questions. Hello, everybody. Nicola from New York City. Hi, Julie from Elk Grove. That's awesome. So thank you, everybody from Alabama and Texas and Indiana and South Carolina. It's so awesome to have you on here today. So we're going to get rock and rolling. Today, we're talking about alternative marketing strategies. And as I get going, please ask questions. Please talk to me inside the webinar so we have a dialogue today, okay? As you know, Breakthrough Broker, real quickly, we have sponsors now on the site. Breakthrough, this particular webinar is sponsored by Breakthrough Plus. Some of you know, all of you know that Breakthrough Broker is 100% free, but we do have an upgraded version now. We hope you love it. And so let's get into alternative marketing strategies and jump right in. You know, what the heck does this mean? Like alternative marketing strategies. And really, I just want you to take this 30 or 40 minute conversation with me and start looking at what you're doing every day a little differently. Start looking at the actions you're taking from the time you wake up in the morning to the time you go to bed in the evening a little differently, because we're going to talk about momentum. We're going to talk about the compound effect of everything you do every day. And unfortunately, sometimes we are busy. Like, how many of you know realtors who are always posting on their social media, oh my gosh, I'm so busy. No one wants to work with someone who is so busy, right? And so what we're going to talk about today isn't necessarily what we do for our business, but really what we do that's productive. We're going to talk about productivity and implementation today, okay? So has anyone ever in your business, we're all in real estate, and if you've been on my past webinars, we just did our marketing action plan and we just did our business plan. And, you know, there's something I'm really passionate about. And that is, if we don't have someone to sell to, none of the other stuff matters, right? So if we tell ourselves we want to be a great negotiator and we want to get all these designations after our name, a CNE, a GRI, a CRS, whatever those stuff are, those designations after our names, those are great. But writing a great contract, being an unbelievable negotiator, dialing your listing contract and your buyer's agreement is all great. And it's part of being a fantastic, well-rounded realtor, but none of it matters if we have no one to do that for, right? So to remind you guys, at the very heart of what we do every day is find people that want to buy or sell real estate. When we wake up in the morning till we go to bed at night and we think real estate and we're working on our jobs or our careers, at the core of what we do, it's finding people to buy and sell real estate. So marketing, our marketing action plan class that we did last month was so important, because we really just talked about how to go out and find people that want to buy or sell real estate. And in that class, we talked a lot about their traditional marketing tactics. And really, we just look around and we see what other realtors are doing, right? we look around and we see that other real estate professionals are doing. Hello from Hawaii. It's early for you this morning. Everyone's like, we're just doing just listed postcards, right? Because we feel that the people in our office, we see it on Facebook, just listed postcards. And then we might do a just sold postcard because we listed and sold it in this market, like in one day, maybe like one half a day. We do some e-newsletters to our sphere of influence. And maybe we do some Facebook posts and we're posting on Facebook. And maybe we're doing some open houses, and in some markets, no open houses, but virtual. What I'm saying here is none of this is wrong, but we're doing most of this because it's what the industry has taught us. We're doing most of this because it's what we see our, hey, by the way, Larry and Ann from Siesta Key, I love Siesta Key, so hope you're having a beautiful day. If I pointed my camera out the window today, you'd see about an inch and a half of snow. It was about 8 degrees this morning here in Denver, but it's warming up nicely. We're going to keep going. So again, guys, none of what I'm showing here is wrong, but we do it just because. Do you ever feel like you're doing it just because? And what happens when you send a just listed postcard out, guys? We created a postcard, we create direct mail. And again, I'm not knocking it. We do it on Breakthrough Broker. I want my wife to do it as part of her business. Nathan and I did it as part of our business. But what's really important to understand is we do that postcard and we send it out. And then what do? We wait, we cross our fingers and we wait for someone to call us, right? And then we do a just listed postcard, or we spend a lot of time on our e-newsletter. And these are great because we're doing them sometimes, like in our business plan, we're doing them for top of mind awareness and all that stuff. That's great, but we're still waiting. So I'm not asking you to not do these things. I'm not saying part of your marketing plan shouldn't be direct mail marketing, geographic farming, sphere, top of mind awareness with your Facebook posts and that stuff. I'm not saying not to do this, but you have to admit all of what we're doing here is we're sitting back and waiting. And sitting back and waiting is scary to me. It was scary. Guys, again, I left a great career. I loved what I did. Chasing bad guys was very rewarding for me. And I got paid every 2 weeks and I didn't pay a penny for my insurance. And they were matching 10% of my 401 and my 457. And all that stuff was amazing, right? So when I got out of that and I wasn't doing both and I was waiting and 100% commission-based, this hope method of success wasn't that great of an idea for me. It didn't feel good for me. And so I think the majority of traditional marketing is waiting. We're waiting for a call. We're waiting for a lead. We're waiting for an email. We're waiting for a payday. And I don't know about you guys, but I hate it. So if we do the traditional success methods, if we added some alternative strategies to what we're already doing, and we go out and get the business, maybe that's going to help us in the long run. Maybe it's going to add to what we're doing every day to find people that want to buy or sell homes. So I couldn't, for me and Nathan, I couldn't wait any longer, right? I just couldn't wait another minute. And so some of you know that I teach this class titled I Shall Not Should on myself, right? Yes, guys, this is being recorded and you will get a recording of this later this afternoon. So the hope, sitting back, crossing my fingers and waiting was driving me crazy, right? And back then I didn't know this, right? But I learned this after I sold our real estate company and started Breakthrough Broker. But I read this essay and it was titled The Common Denominator of Success. And in the essay, I found this excerpt where he says to me, when I'm reading it, he says, the secret of success of every man or woman has ever been successful lies in the fact that he or she formed the habits of doing things that failures don't like to do. I'll say it again. The secret of success of every man or woman who's ever been successful lies in the fact that he or she formed the habits of doing the things that failures don't like to do. Now, I didn't know this at the time, but I was done. We were done waiting for the business. So we realized really early on, Nathan and I, that momentum was so important. And we talked to each other. We're like, what can we do every day? What can we do every day to go out and just find business, right? And we were so intensely focused on this momentum thing. And I'm a sports fan, and I hope some some of you guys are sports fans on this call, in sports, right? If you're thinking about sports and you look at who wins at the end of the game, it's typically the team with the most momentum. That's how underdogs win. That's how go Chiefs, go Broncos. I have all kinds of things coming in. Go Broncos is going to be a long time, Michael, because the Chiefs are pretty darn good. But anyway, as we keep going, thanks for the comments, guys. What a great group here. So the momentum is what we really focused on first, because we felt that as we sat and waited for our traditional marketing tactics to work, we had no momentum. We were flat-footed. Again, those of you who love sports, as you're flat-footed, people run around you, right? And I felt like I saw other realtors closing more deals while I was sitting back and waiting for all of these things to happen, right? So we focused on momentum. And what Nathan and I did at the time was we decided, and this is a true story, guys. You can ask Nathan. You guys can ask anyone we sold in our town with. Nathan and I, this is right after I quit the police department and Nathan quit his job. We went full in on real estate, opened our own real estate brokerage. We started to go to 2 lunches per day with coffees in between every single day. We did it for almost over a year. We were just trying to build momentum. We'd go to an early lunch and then we'd have a late lunch and we'd have coffees and people would say, you eat a lot, because I would not eat in the early lunch. They'd say, I don't eat. And then the late lunch, I'd be starving. But we were just trying to get out there, and it was important. And I was trying to think to myself, I was racking my brain at the time, because remember, I was panicking. I retired from the police department after 13 years, a great career and a steady paycheck. And I woke up the next morning in a panic, like a true panic attack, because my security blanket was gone. So I had to decide, who was I going to call today? Who can I help today? Who can I work with today? Who can I connect with today? And it wasn't really about me. It wasn't about me calling someone and saying, hey, I'm in real estate, can you give me referrals? It was just about the conversation. And that conversation is what started to drive more business. I'll explain to you here in a minute. That conversation is what started to drive new business. So the first takeaway from today is this. I want you to analyze your sphere of influence. We don't do this enough. I want you to analyze your sphere of influence. Tiffany Phillips says urgency. Tiffany, let me give you an example. Anyone on this call ever been slow and had a vacation coming up? Anyone? And it's Murphy's Law. I hear the jokes all the time in our industry, and I see it on Lab Coat Agents and all the Facebook groups. You ever plan a vacation and then all of a sudden you post on your Facebook, if you want to get busy, just plan a vacation. Guys, it's no joke, right? It's not a coincidence. I'm going to say it again. When you go on vacation, getting busy before vacation is not a coincidence. Do you know why? Because you're starting to feel guilty about going on vacation when you're a commission only person. What do you do 3 to 4 weeks ahead of your vacation? You start to do all the things you should have been doing the last 3 months. You start making phone calls. You start getting your things done. You start making some lunches and touching base. And because you're worried that you're going to be gone for a week or 2 weeks. This is the reason and the science behind the fact that you get busy before you go on vacation. So why don't you treat that business, your business, like you're going on vacation all the time? And then, so Tiffany says urgency. You're darn right, urgency. You feel urgency about getting some momentum before your vacation and you didn't even know you were doing it. Now, off my soapbox, back to this thing called analyze your sphere of influence. This is alternative marketing strategy number one. I want you to look at your SOI. Okay, sphere of influence. Now, I want you to look at it and I want you to make it a popularity contest. I want you to start grouping your sphere of influence. Now, I want you to look up your top 10 most influential people. Now, this isn't wealthiest, isn't richest, isn't someone who lives in the biggest house. I'm talking top 10 most influential people in your sphere of influence. Okay, this is your popularity contest. Who are the most popular, influential, outspoken individuals in your sphere of influence. And this is very important. Okay. So some of you guys, I have some people asking me, we can't do lunches right now. We can't do coffees. It's COVID restrictions. I don't have a large sphere of influence. I'll address that. Okay. It's a very valid point right now. We'll address it. All right. Don't let me forget to address that. Okay. Yes, Amarita, this is being recorded. So in your sphere of influence, I want you to analyze your top 10 most influential people in your sphere of influence. Okay, guys. Then I want you to group your next 10 and your next 10 and your next 10 all the way till all of groups of 10 are placed in your CRM. All right. I'm not even going to get on my CRM soapbox today, guys. I should, but I'm not. You guys should all have a CRM. Now, again, remember, it's top 10 most influential, then the next, and the next. When you're done, you're not done. I want you to go back to your sphere of influence, and I want you to interview your significant other, spouse, boyfriend, girlfriend, significant other, your parents, your neighbors, your mortgage and title partners, your spouse's parents. Okay. I want you to ask, who do you know that I should know? I want you to ask, and guys, you're going to get pushback. At the time I did this, this was pre-Joanna. At the time I did this, I asked my girlfriend about this, and she said, I don't know. We know the same amount of people. And Cody was a bartender at a local bar. And finally, she said, you know what? I do know a guy, and he's a regular here, and his name's Danny, and I think he's in real estate. And I said, a real estate agent? Because I'm not real interested in that. She's like, no, in real estate. So I put him in my CRM as Danny, regular at Cody's bar. First name Danny, second name, last name, regular at Cody's bar. Then I put a task to remind myself to have Cody call me next time he was in. And she did. He was in. I went and met him. Turns out he was a developer of a 300-acre luxury project in the town next to us on a lake. Great contact, right? So this stuff works. Interview your boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife, significant others. Put those people in your sphere of influence and then start grouping them again. How popular are they? It's a popularity contest. Want your sphere to be as complete as humanly possible, right? As complete as humanly possible. Now, once we've got that done and we start to schedule our meetings, once we get that done, Glenn says, how do I define most influential? Guys, this is a popularity contest. I'm gonna explain it to you in a bit when we look at some of my top 10. When I look at my top 10, I'm gonna show that to you. But it's friends who you know have, it's those people that have a party every weekend. It's those people that have huge people who follow them. It doesn't necessarily mean most followers on Facebook. I'm not really talking about that. You're getting very literal. I'm talking about the most influential. You know, if they sit on multiple boards and those people are always, you know, when you see people on Facebook who are like looking to go on date night with my wife, anyone know a good restaurant? This is pre-COVID, obviously. Although we can go back to restaurants here in Denver. And it's that first person that always pops up and says, hey, I went to L5 last week and I loved it so much. It was amazing. You guys should check it out. That person's pretty influential and willing to jump in. Tiffany says noisy neighbors. Exactly. So that's what I'm talking about by most influential. Okay. And just keep grouping them. We're going to keep going, guys. All right. So what to say on when we're making those calls, because I get some pushback here. They're like, Eric, that's great. I think it's fantastic that you're asking me to go to coffee meetings every day, or, you know, we right now we can't go to coffee. So I'm asking you to use some Zoom coffees or some Zoom happy hours. Okay, guys, everyone's doing Zoom. Don't be afraid of that. So I might just say, look, I love to connect with like-minded business individuals and love to grab lunch or coffee to brainstorm, or I'm scheduling some coffee meetings via Zoom and I hear you have great ideas about your business. I'd love to learn more. Can we have coffee over Zoom? So the dialogue isn't that difficult, and even easier, you can say the events of the past year have had me thinking about you and I thought we could connect for coffee or lunch. How hard is that, guys? Now, what do you say when you go to coffee or lunch? Like, is that difficult? Is that hard? Are you scared of that? Guys, it's just conversation. If you're scared of going to lunch with somebody, real estate may not be your best vocation, your best career. You're just going to lunch. It's a conversation. Now, you may be, my suggestion on this, and maybe we'll do a webinar someday on this, is my suggestion is maybe asking them more about them than you. So get them talking more about themselves, ask about their business, ask about their family, ask how the kids are doing. Well, how did their business get through or their job get through the pandemic? And invariably they're going to ask about you at some point. You're going to say real estate's going great. It's pretty amazing. There's low inventory right now. Things are selling in like an hour. And that's how those conversations may or may not go. Okay, guys. So we're going to keep going and get through some of this. So let's look at my sphere of influence, or a sphere of influence that Nathan and I might have done when we were working on this. Okay. Now, we were still doing traditional marketing. Nathan and I were doing our newsletters, and we were doing open houses, and we were doing all of the things that we thought we should do, but we didn't want to wait. So I called a very influential member of my kid's school. I knew her from when I worked at the police department, and she worked in the child advocacy center, and we talked. And I asked her how things were going and if we could go for a coffee. At that point, you know, why would I take her out? She was so popular. Everyone loved her, right? So when she would, like, if someone was moving out of the elementary school, who would they tell, right? So the idea was that I'm creating a dialogue, I'm making connections, and I'm planting seeds, all right? It's really the momentum. I had a college buddy who had the largest carpet cleaning business in the area, and he threw parties every single weekend. Every weekend, bar none, he threw a party. People loved him. He was vivacious, outgoing. Everybody loved him. So we went to lunch. I asked how things were going. He said, I asked if I could do anything for him. And he said, you know, do you know any property managers? And I really didn't at the time. And I said, sure, you know, you fake it till you make it. And he said, if you could get me in to do some clean outs for some of these rentals, that'd be super helpful. And so I helped him with that. And in turn, over the years, we got leads from him. One of my ex-coworkers at the police department started to run the training division. He was very popular. He was super handsome. He was an ex-mixed martial arts fighter. Everyone looked up to him. And so when I asked him if I could take him to lunch and coffee, and I had this idea of how I could help some of the spouses, husbands and wives of police officers who were having trouble with the transition, if I could create a class for them and maybe meet them, he agreed to it. So I'm going out and I'm thinking of ideas on how I can help other people that might end up helping me with my business. So as I'm going through this, guys, are you thinking about your sphere? Are you thinking to yourself, I know people like this? I hope so, because they're in there. These are the golden nuggets, the diamonds in your sphere of influence that you never thought about this way. Okay. The residential land developer, early stages of 100-acre custom home subdivision. That was that guy. The hospital recruiter. This is crazy. I actually asked my mortgage partner if she knew anybody that could help me. And at first she's like, no, Eric, you know, I can't, you know, do that. I have worked with a lot of realtors. And then she was like, you know, I actually know the recruiter at the hospital district. Let me connect you guys. And the recruiter at the hospital district, she didn't want to meet with me. She actually had many other realtors she worked with. And if you don't know, in my area, and if I have anyone on this call from Fort Collins, we work in Fort Collins where ninja selling was born, right? So the Group Inc, it's tough to be up against them in your industry at that point, at that time in our career. The hospital used them, right? And so I met Erica, the hospital recruiter. We became friends. I took her to coffees and lunches. And over time, we started to get referrals of doctors moving in to the area. As a matter of fact, if I'm going to tell you a quick story, I was number two for a year and a half. Their number one messed up and didn't show up one day. And she called me and she's like, can you swing by? I need you to do a community tour for a surgeon coming into the area. I said, sure. So I pulled up. I got him in my car, asked if he liked beer. He said, of course I like beer. So I took him to, in my town, we had New Belgium Brewery. So if you like Fat Tire, we went over there, we popped in there, looked around. Then we went up the hill to the reservoir, looked over that, looked at the mountains, looked back, drove him by the high schools and the daycare and back to the hospital. And he was so excited. And she called me and she said, oh my God, he loved you. And then I started getting these tours all the time. So we started doing relocation for the hospital district. I was introduced by a mutual friend in real estate school who did property management and not resale to an HR director at the largest solar company in Colorado. And I took her to lunch and started getting these relationships. So guys, this is how I want you to see in your sphere, these people, why would an HR director be so influential to your business? Those people are firing and hiring people all the time. They have people who are getting raises and might want to be moving. And that momentum is amazing. Our number one lead source, I got to thinking, and remember, I was brainstorming. And I remembered my buddy in real estate school. His name was Kevin. And I remembered that he was taking over his father-in-law's business of corporate housing, short-term housing, 78 units. So I called him and I said, hey, I think we can work together. I said, what are you talking about? I said, who's in your corporate housing? He said, mainly people living there that were relocated there who are probably going to stay here. And then like a lot of divorcees and a lot of people in this short-term housing. I said, awesome. I don't want names. I just want you to give me the address of any new people coming into the unit. And then Nathan and I would deliver a basket to that unit, and they would get like a list of all the closest Chinese food places, best burger in town, and a little certificate for a free community tour. And that became our number one lead source. We weren't waiting. Kevin was calling me every week and sending me new names, new units, because I was paying him a 25% referral. He bought a home, a new home, based on all of the referrals we gave him all year long for years and years. And it just came out of thinking a little outside the box. Who can I help today? Who can I work with? Who's influential? Who knows a lot of people that I can communicate with to start bringing in some of the business? Okay, guys. So I also went to the property management company in town. There's two or three. And we asked for their vacate notices. Some did it, some wouldn't do it. This is really interesting. I asked them to just give me the addresses of people who are vacating. And then we went and tried to get their business as first-time homebuyers. You can either email, you can do door hangers, you can go door knocking. I mean, we're not doing a ton of door knocking right now. But the whole idea here is that now, okay, also, I played ice hockey every night in an old guys league, and we never talked business, but the guy next to me one night, he was lacing his skates up, and he's like, hey, you're in real estate, right? And I'm like, yeah. He's like, I'm a divorce attorney. I have a crazy divorce going on right now, and I need to list this house. And they hate their, you know, the husband hates their current realtor because it's sided with the wife and whatever. And so that worked out great for me. And then we started working with divorce attorneys. So the idea is that we had all of those people we were working with. And we call it the compound effect of every action we're taking. Guys, watch this. If you pick up the phone tomorrow and you make 10 phone calls and you have 10 great conversations, okay? Those 10 conversations are going to get 5 follow-up actions, okay? Maybe they said to themselves, you know, I hated my house during the pandemic. I'd love to know what it was worth, okay? And I'd love to know what it was worth. And then, so that's a follow-up action. Then you do 10 calls on Friday and you have 5 more follow-ups. Now, next week, you have 10 follow-ups, 10 more calls to do. And this is where going out and getting the business works. So let's look at the numbers, guys. Let's look at the numbers, okay? So let's just say the kids' school involvement, helping out at the school, talking to my friend who was really the most popular person in the school, would garner 10 leads a year over time. None of this happens immediately. Let's say over time, I would get 7 leads from my buddy, and the police department would give me about 15 leads a year, and the land developer about 5 leads a year, the hospital district recruiter about 15 leads per year. I was doing about a little over one community tour a month for them. The solar company, about 12 leads a year. Woodward Governor, I was getting about 12 leads a year. Short-term housing was giving us about 30. Property management, about 20. So we're looking at about 139 leads in a year, right? So let's go back to that, okay? So all these numbers are just referrals. Not even, I call them leads, but they're just like, hey, Eric, here's another surgeon coming into town. Can you take him on a call? Hey, Eric, you know, we're hiring someone to run the solar fields. Do you want to give them a community tour? Feel free. All of those things become, again, all of that. So we've got 139 people we're communicating with over time, but let's look at the numbers. If you only convert 40%, and that is a terribly low number, because if you're getting a lead given to you, typically you're going to convert higher, but let's just say that's 56 new clients at a 40% conversion. Average sale price, 300,000, which is fairly low right now. That's 16 million in sales volume or 504,000 in gross commission income. At that point, you start to see a compounding effect. At that point, you say to yourself, all right, I got 56 new clients in a year, and I got 56 new clients in year two, and 56 new clients in year three. And now I have 168 past clients in the fourth year. You don't have to spend a penny on marketing. That referral engine is done. You know, we've spoken to so many top producing realtors in the industry who say, I don't have to lead gen at all. I have all my past clients referring me, and I'm doing, you know, 20, 30, 40, 60, 100, 150 transactions a year because I've kept in touch with everyone. I've gone to lunches with everyone. I've asked how I can help. I'm calling, I'm doing traditional marketing by staying in front of them on Facebook and newsletters and being valuable to my sphere. Over time, you don't have to keep doing this, okay? So the whole idea here is that compounding growth, you start getting referrals from these clients, you keep getting referrals from your sphere of influence, and year over year, it compounds so you don't have to do it. Now, I told you guys, this is in addition to your traditional marketing strategies. I know that you guys have some diamonds inside, you have gold, diamonds, gold, whatever, inside your particular sphere of influence, okay? It's in there. So you have to start looking at it that way. It's not easy. That's why I showed you in the beginning that excerpt that says the best agents in the world are doing what the other agents really don't love to do. It's hard to make these calls. It costs money to go to lunch, costs money to go to coffee. It takes courage to do a Zoom happy hour. It takes courage to do a Zoom class for your neighborhood or your sphere of influence that says state of the market. It's really scary, right? So those things are hard and it doesn't happen overnight. So for Nathan and I, those leads weren't overnight. We just started getting those over time. It takes some money in systems. You need a CRM. You need to be willing to spend some money on this stuff, and you can't screw up. If you mess up, you might lose a lead source forever, right? I was getting 30 leads a year from my friend who owned the business, the short-term housing business. And if I messed one up, I think that would have gone away. He was really adamant about customer service and I think he felt any other realtor could do that with him. So we had to be really careful and be consistent in your thank yous. You know, we didn't pay for any of these leads. We developed relationships. They were happy to give them off to us because we did an amazing job and we thanked them. We thanked them. Now you have Facebook and Instagram. You can thank people publicly and they'll feel really good about that. And they'll give you more referrals. So the whole idea for today was to get you to start thinking differently about your business. It was to look at you personally and the people you know and strategizing on what lunches, what coffees, what momentum can I build today? What email, who can I call? Who can I strategize with today to build that compound momentum to start getting leads in so that you're not just waiting. And again, the traditional marketing tactics work. If used consistently over time, geographic marketing, sphere of influence newsletters and marketing and referral-based marketing works. But if you mix in one or two of these ideas, if you communicate with three divorce attorneys in town and you give them a little package and tell them why you're better than any other realtor, and you start getting two or three deals a year from that, amazing, because next year you might get four or five from them. And the next year you might get 8 or 10. And so all of that stuff really works in your favor. Start thinking differently. I hope I was able to in 34 minutes. It's a shorter webinar today. I hope in 34 minutes you were able to look at your business and say, all right, I don't have to rely on waiting. I can go out and start making my business happen. I can go out and have lunches and coffees. I can create a class and do a Zoom meeting and drive people in and have great conversations. So please think of it that way. I have some nice, thank you, Ed. Thank you, Lindsay. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Gina, Mimi. Some good comments here. This is not earth shattering, guys. It's just reminding you that you have this inside the people you know. Group them, go out and get more business. We hope you sell more this year. Please check out Breakthrough Plus. We love what we do on Breakthrough Broker and we've enhanced it greatly. So please check that out, Breakthrough Plus on breakthroughbroker.com. And we will see you next month on our webinar. So keep an eye out. Bye, everybody.